seniors, attendees, and everyone. On behalf of the Educational Board of Mega Medical Association and the Egyptian Society of Anesthesiology, I'm honored, me and Dr. Saha, to moderate a new session of the Mega Medical course. Today we have three interesting sessions for three great lectures. To start with, we are starting with a new pearls diving in the ocean of knowledge of Professor Dr. Samir Elansary, who is an ICU professor in Ain Shams University, Cairo, Egypt. Today he is giving us a lecture on a very important topic. No matter how senior or junior we are, we can definitely benefit from this lecture. He's today giving us a lecture on congestive heart failure. Dr. Samir, would you kindly please start?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you, Dr. Hoda. Good evening, my dear colleague. Today, I am going to continue my stress on the knowledge about the shock and related items. And I think we speak in last week about the inotropic and vasopressors in cases of many types of shock and how to utilize everyone and understand the mechanism of its action. Today, I am going to stress on important point, which is the congestive heart failure and the broad lines of management of congestive heart failure. And as intensivist, we have to be oriented with the underlying pathology, in short, and also what is the lines of management and what is the lines of treatment, and what are the factors which precipitate a patient with heart disease and shifting him to ICU and precipitating shifting him from decompensated state to from compensated state to decompensated state. And so we have to understand these broad lines in management or in dealing with a cardiac patient. What is a congestive heart failure? Of course, it is an abnormality of cardiac functions in which there is the heart can't supply the metabolic needs to the tissue. It can do so only with an elevated filling pressure. If it can do it with elevated filling pressure, this is a state also of stage of heart failure. And we have to differentiate, of course, between the systolic and diastolic heart failure. Always in systolic heart failure or forward heart failure, in which is perfusion pressure is decreased and the tissue perfusion is inadequate. And there is also back pressure from systolic heart failure affecting mainly the lung and causing pulmonary edema. It also decreases organ perfusion like kidney, and the kidney start and the renal tissue start to secrete renin and renin angiotensin system, which is the main underlying pathology for the progressive state of heart failure. In the diastolic heart failure, really, it is a filling problem. It is a filling problem. The diastolic muscle becoming ischemic, becoming stenotic, fibrotic. The relaxation power of it is inadequate. And the manifestation mainly of diastolic failure is a backward or systemic congestion, like jugular venous pressure increased and liver cirrhosis, ascites, varices, and so on, we find in the diastolic failure. And the most of the patient accepting both types of failure in the same patients. But we have to be oriented with the differentiation between the two. And sometimes some doctors depend only on ejection fraction. Ejection fraction in systolic failure, of course, it is decreased, but sometimes it may be maintained in some people, and even with function impairment. But in diastolic ejection, the ejection fraction is always normal or increased. In contrast to systolic ejection fraction is low. We have to understand the underlying pathology which occur during decreased cardiac output or decreased heart pumping effect. the arterial blood pressure will go down, and so the other, the underlying mechanism of the body will start to act for to avoid this hypotension, to increase the blood pressure. And so there is activation of sympathetic nervous system, and there is widespread vasoconstrictions and increase in the afterload. Also, the renin angiotensin aldosterone system start to work, which is the main problem in a congestive heart failure, which lead to progressive increase or deterioration in heart function. Yes, at start, it is beneficial. At start, it will cause sodium retention, water retention, compensate vasoconstriction to try to compensate for this hypotension. At the same time, but on the in chronic state, if persist this mechanism, increase sympathetic and RAS system stimulation, it will lead to cardiac dysfunction and cardiac modulation and fibrosis and hypertrophy and so on. And so there are other mechanisms which is very important, and they depend on it now for their research to create new drugs to treat heart failure, which is the natriuretic peptide, which are secreted after distension of the ventricle. When the ventricular diastolic pressure increase and the ventricular end systolic and then diastolic volume indices increase and the pressure indices increase, and there is distension of the ventricular muscle is starting to secrete the BNP or the cardiac BNP. Also the brain will secrete this natriuretic peptide and the vessels also. And so this natriuretic peptide really try to antagonize this underlying bad mechanism in chronic state, not in the acute state. In the acute state, yes, it carry a good action to maintain the blood pressure and maintain the tissue perfusion. But if persist in a chronic state, it will lead to chronic dysfunction in the cardiac muscle. And so the natriuretic peptide really is very important as a protective to the cardiac muscle. It try to has many actions. It causes decrease in the venous tone, it causes decrease in the blood volume and more diuresis and more sodium loss, water loss, and so on. And so it protects the heart from this persistent vasoconstriction and oversympathetic drive. And as I told you before, oversympathetic drive is very bad, either to the tissue perfusion or to the cardiac muscle. And so the resistant sympathetic stimulation or overstimulation or even more aggressive treatment of those patients with noradrenaline, adrenaline, and the other vasoconstrictors and other adrenergic factors are not so good for and carry a high mortality. The cardiac distension and sympathetic stimulation and angiotensin II activations when the cardiac muscle go down, it leads the heart to secrete the ANP atrial natriuretic peptide and BNP and ventricular natriuretic peptide, which decrease, as I said, the renin secretion from the renal tissue. And so there is drop in angiotensin II and aldosterone, and they will lead to vasodilatation and decrease the blood pressure and the blood volume will be decreased. And so decreasing the afterload and the preload, which is required for the cardiac muscle to perform its action adequately. And so as I told, in short term, neurohumoral activation system is very good for maintaining the tissue perfusion, but on long term, it will lead to pulmonary edema and systemic congestion and increasing the afterload and the myocardial dysfunction and the fibrotic myocardium and remodeling and so on. We have to evaluate, of course, if we want to evaluate our patient, we depend, as you know, on the history, what is the risk factor in his life for ischemic heart disease, family history, if it is genetic. Also, physical examination important to detect the S3 and the jugular venous distension, more specific of heart failure, then rails and peripheral edema. Basic chemistry is very important. CBC, most of the cardiac failure patients excepting some pneumonia. The pneumonia is very bad prognostic factor. It leads to hypertonic circulation and the cardiac hypertrophy and lead to more deterioration and the decompensation rapidly. TSH also either high or low, and thyroid functions, if it is hypo or hyper. BNP really is a good predictor of heart disease. And if it is less than 100 picogram per ml, it will exclude the cardiac dysfunction or cardiac cause for this for any symptoms to the patient. And even if it is less than 50 picogram, it will carry a high specificity and sensitivity to exclude cardiac causes to cause any problem to patient. Assess the decompensation, measure response to therapy, and so brain neutralytic peptide or BNP is a good prognostic, good diagnostic, and good prognostic factor, a lab factor for depending on it. Other lab as directed by the history, iron status is very, very important. Most of cardiac patients exhibiting anemia of iron deficiency anemia and so require iron supplementation. Confirming the presence of heart failure, we have to proceed to make X-ray, chest X-ray, to see if there is any cardiomegaly, any pulmonary edema, curly beer lines. These are diagnostic, and you will see the pulmonary vessels congested and so on. Lab value as BNP, as I told, also as other diseases, as thyroid function, and also we have to see if the patient suffering from other diseases as obesity or steroid use and so on. Echocardiography is very important, really. It will reveal many underlying problems, especially in advanced case of congestive heart failure, may be revealed for you cardiac hypertrophy, valvular heart disease, any pericardial effusion. And so it is very good and helping you even in detecting the ejection fraction and other parameters for management or for helping you to manage your patient. ECG, very important. You can detect, predict all the Q wave, all the infarction, left bundle branch block, hypertrophy, and so on. Physical finding, which we see in our patient with congestive heart failure, a major criteria as dyspnea, especially orthopnea and paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, neck vein distension, rails, cardiomegaly, pulmonary edema, S3 gallop, hepatojugular reflux. Also the minor criteria like ankle edema, nocturnal cough due to congestion, pulmonary congestion, dyspnea on ordinary exertion, hepatomegaly, pleural effusion, tachycardia, and arrhythmia, which is very important in precipitating decompensation in the heart muscle. And we must know there is a discordance between severity of systolic dysfunction and the degree of functional impairment, and is not really well understood. Yeah, patient with very low left ventricular ejection fractions may be asymptomatic in some patients. And patient even with preserved left ventricular systolic function may have many, many symptoms. And so there is a discordance between the ejection fraction and between the symptoms of the symptomatology of the patient. Of course, there is a poor prognostic factor or poor prognostic indicators like hypotension, like presence of coronary artery disease, elevated blood urea nitrogen or creatinine, hyponatremia, not hypernatremia, hyponatremia due to fluid collections and edema, low ejection fraction, poor functional capacity, elevated BNP, as I told, or troponin, also anemia, very important to manage anemia in such patients. Diabetes mellitus, of course, very important to be managed adequately. Also increased age, smoking, increased pulmonary cap, wedge pressure, atrial fibrillation, any type of arrhythmia really may carry the patient from compensated state to decompensation. What is the causes of decompensation in congestive heart failure? Maybe environmental factors, excess salt or excess fluid. Patient not compliance with the medications he's taking, maybe not adequate medications or not follow the adequate doses of medications. Maybe adverse medications effect and interactions of several medications which received in such patients. Also, there are cardiovascular risk factors like acute ischemia, infarction, pulmonary embolism, very important, and controlled hypertension, which is very important to be treated in such patients, and even to the target 130 over 80, especially in renal patients. Also, arrhythmia must be treated in such patients adequately. Worse valve dysfunctions also may precipitate. Also endocarditis and an infection. Extracardiac causes which lead to more progression of congestive heart failure, sepsis, infection, hypoxia, renal failure, thyroid disease, either hyper or hypo, anemia, blood loss, sleep apnea, and must be treated with CPAP, bilateral renal artery stenosis. All these factors really are risk factors in patients suffering from heart failure. And there are other precipitating causes which may bring your patients from ordinary ward to your ICU, like coronary artery disease, systemic hypertension not treated well, idiopathic diabetes, mitis, valvular heart disease. Also, as I told, anemia, connective tissue disease, viral myocarditis, hemochromatosis, HIV, hyper and hypothyroidism. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, infiltrative disease, including amyloidosis and sarcoidosis affect the muscle itself, mediastinal radiation also, prepartum cardiomyopathy, common after pregnancy, after delivery, restrictive pericardial disease, very important, tachyarrhythmia, toxins, and trypanosomiasis or Chagas disease. Treatment goals of congestive heart failure in general, we have to improve the quality of life. We have many drugs which relieve the symptoms, just relieving the system, not affecting the mortality, but it brings the patient to a more better quality of life. Very important. Alleviate symptoms and improve activity tolerance gradually, of course. Prevent progressive myocardial dysfunctions and also try to prolong life by drugs, by medication, and even by surgery. Principles of treatment which we have to decrease the preload, afterload, and increase the inotropic action of the cardiac muscle, and decrease the neurohumoral activity, which is RAS, renal angiotensin aldosterone system, and also there are other factors like immune state, because in heart failure, there is activations of B cells and activations of the autoimmune pathway. Due to, of course, the release of cytokines and inflammatory mediators, which are depressant to the cardiac muscle. Heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, the basic principles of treatment, as we will see now, we will use angiotensin converting enzymes inhibitors. We can use also angiotensin 2 receptor blockers, ARB. Also, angiotensin receptor neprilysin inhibitors, ARNI, which inhibit neprilysin system, endoglutatase system, and so prevent the destruction or metabolism of the natriuretic peptide, which is beneficial, as I said. As well as the mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, which has spironolactone or eplerenone, and the beta blockers, of course, and try to treat other comorbidity like iron deficiency, diabetes mellitus, hyperkalemia, as we will see now. This is a summary of how to proceed for treating the heart failure patients according to his stage of suffering. Stage one, no structure lesion, no symptoms. You have to treat the risk factor reductions, smoking, obesity, diabetes, patient, family education, and so on. If the patient, and also try if the patient suffering from hypertension, treat hypertension, diabetes, dyslipidemia, you can use ACE inhibitors or ARBs in some patients. If the patient starts to exhibiting some structural heart disease, but with no symptoms, we can start ACE inhibitors or ARBs and also maybe beta blockers. If the patient have structural disease and symptoms already, we have to consider all the other policy of treatment as ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, dietary, of course, sodium restriction, diuretic, digoxin. Cardiac resynchronization, especially if bundle branch block, revascularization, mitral valve surgery, consider multidisciplinary team, aldosterone antagonist, and other drugs like nisertib. Patient exhibiting severe heart for refractory symptoms requiring special intervention, you can use the inotropes which we speak about it before, like norepinephrine, NORAD, levosimendan, calcium sensitizer, and other inotropes, mineral phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitors, and so on, which is the IV drugs used commonly in the ICU. And also, we can shift directly to device supplementation or device support, like intra-aortic balloon, ventricular assist device, impeller, and the other devices. And the, lastly, the hospice. Therapeutic approach identify there are some reversible pathogenic processes like heparinating myocardium and stunted myocardium and the sepsis associated myocardium depression and myocardial inflammation, myocarditis. And if we select this specific treatment for such situations, we can relieve and improve the conditions like a state of heparinating myocardium and stunted as occur in during CABG. During the clamping the coronary artery, of course, the part of muscle is affected, and by after releasing the muscle will be perfused and improve in its actions. It may take time, may take several days, from hours to several days, as post op CABG. Heparinating myocardium also in atherosclerotic patient, if you will affect the cardiac muscle, if you use the specific treatment in such cases as nitroglycerin, or you can make post-CABG operations, yeah, the muscle will be improved within hours to several days, of course. Other problem which we hear about it, Takotsubo, or stress cardiomyopathy, or broken heart, or apical ballooning syndrome, or apical cardiomyopathy, or stress cardiomyopathy. This syndrome occurs, it's discovered in Japan, in 1991, and it is really mainly due to stress. A patient entered in a great accident or in grief loss of relatives and so on, mostly due to adrenergic stimulation, which lead to ballooning of the cardiac muscles, and they may mimic the acute MI really. Even in ECG, you can find the Q wave, the T wave inversion, ECT segment elevation, and so on. And we see some cases in postmenopausal also. And the troponin here not persisting rise, patient not existing persistent troponin rise, no. He will exhibit small rapid increase and the fall of troponin out of proportion to degree of left ventricular wall motion abnormality. Really, it is uncommon, but it carry a high mortality rate. And so we must be oriented with it, and we have to treat it as we treat MI, but we have to be to differentiate between it and MI. If we make angio, we will find the coronary artery normal in such cases. It is precipitated, I said, by extreme emotional stress mostly, or physical stress, for example, argument, domestic abuse, death in a family, financial reversal, hip fracture, and so excess catecholamine is the main factor for causing that. And we see here the ECG mostly similar to MI, but of course there is some point of differentiation. It's not our topic now. Tokusobo is a transient regional systolic dysfunction involving a kinesis of left ventricular apex and the mid ventricle with hypercontracting basal area, no coronary stenosis documented with urgent angiography. Wall motion abnormality doesn't correspond to a single coronary distribution. So it is not due to pathological coronary arteries. And it takes different figures, as we see. We can see ballooning at the apex or apex mid-ventricular during the systole here, maybe ballooning at the apex here, maybe at the basal area, not in the apex. It has four types really. And mostly the patient who accepting the Takotsubo or suffering from Takotsubo complaining from psychiatric problem and the neurological problem. Myocarditis could be treated really easily, of course, with prednisone, and it will take some time, especially dilated cardiomyopathy due to myocarditis. We speak now about most of the common drugs which we can use in congestive heart failure. Not inside the ICU. In the ICU, of course, we depend on the inotropic agents and vasotropic agents. But of course, our patient, if admitted to ICU, he of course, taking supportive treatment to his heart failure. I am going to discuss these most common drugs which we can find it with our patient inside the ICU. As ACE inhibitors, this is a very, very important line of treatment for systolic heart failure and even diastolic heart failure also. It inhibits the overstimulation of RAS system. And so it acts on the renin-angiotensin aldosterone system. It decreases its efficacy and causes balanced vasodilation and decreases the rate of morbidity and mortality. And if treating acute heart failure, can start after blood pressure to rate and pulmonary edema is relieved. Take care, for first few doses may cause hypotension, and you have to follow the renal function after starting also ACE inhibitors. ACE inhibitors also, it has some side effect as cough, angioedema, because bradykinin is increased, alter the taste. Hyperkalemia is very important in such drugs and treatment, and dizziness. Hypotension and lightheadedness are common side effects of ACE inhibitors, particularly in patients with marked activation of RAS system. Hold the diuretic, of course, during treatment, especially with the first doses of ACE inhibitors, and titrate slowly going up till to obtain the optimum and effective dose of ACE inhibitors. If your patient suffering from this side effect, cough, angioedema, altered taste, hyperkalemia, and so on, you can shift to angiotensin receptor blockers. Comparable to ACE inhibitors, good, also suitable alternative, but also they may cause hyperkalemia. And so you must be alert to the hyperkalemic state which may occur in such patient, especially patient also treated with mineralocorticoid antagonists like spironolactone and ibilirimod. ACE inhibitors are preferred drugs for congestive heart failure due to left ventricular systolic dysfunction because they are associated with low mortality. Combination of hydralazine, isoflurane, dinitrate also carry the same effect like ACE inhibitors if the patient is not tolerating this one. ACE inhibitors, some doctors advise ACE inhibitors plus ARB. It is not indicated really, and it will increase the creatinine and lead to more hypotension and hyperkalemia. Depend only on one drug line. Don't use both drugs in the same patient. The main problem in our patient using ACE inhibitors, as I said, and the ARBs and aldosterone antagonists and so on, is the hyperkalemia. And the many patients, we can't reach the optimum dose of ACE inhibitor or ARB during the treatment due to hyperkalemia. And so in addition to our traditional methods and our traditional lines of management of hyperkalemia, like glucose insulin infusion, like bicarbonate infusion, calcium infusion, and so on, there are two specific drugs to lowering the potassium level in such patient rapidly. Especially also, we can use it in renal failure patient with hyperkalemia. Betromir and zirconium. Really, they are act locally in the GIT. Betromir work as exchanger to potassium is exchanged with calcium, and it is a very effective drug in lowering the potassium level. Potassium binder indication treatment of hyperkalemia, and it used as oral suspension, oral powder, and it is very effective in lowering the potassium, and so we can use our traditional treatment and going up with the optimum dose of ACE inhibitors and ARBs, which in some situations we can't use fully really because of hyperkalemia. Also, the other drug is zirconium, sodium zirconium cyclosilicate. It is very effective, and this one acts also in decreasing potassium absorption in the gastrointestinal tract. Beta blocker, the other line of treatment of heart failure, what I think most of you is oriented with that, is similar to RAS and very important in for inhibition. Doses of beta blocker should be increased to recommended target dose. We always start with small doses and going up with till we reach the optimum dose, which the optimum for our patient. Of course, heart rate increased heart rate very problem and so problematic in heart failure. And so we try to decrease that with beta blockers, especially. We can use isoprolol, we can use metoprolol, carvedilol, any one of them could be used, no difference between them. You can use the available one and the one which you are oriented with at more. Tachycardia, of course, will precipitate more ischemia, will decrease the diastolic time and decrease the coronary perfusion, will increase the arterial stiffness, will increase the oxygen consumption and the duration, the diastole will be decreased, the coronary perfusion will be decreased. And so, better to treat elevated heart rate as a protection to heart failure or protection and prevent exaggeration of heart failure. Beta blockers are contraindicated, of course, in patient with heart block, 30 degrees, second degree heart block. Also in patient with severe asthma, bronchial asthma, but in patient with mild asthma could be used. And even patient with COPD, we can use beta blockers, no contraindication. But you have to follow your patients, and if he is deteriorate our pulmonary function, excepting deterioration, you have to decrease the dose or stop it. This is a beta blocker, different beta blocker, no significant difference we found among the varying substance, as I said. Also, suppose you give the beta blocker and your patient still have left ventricular ejection fraction less than 35% and the heart rate more than 70 beat per minute, you have to use the drug evobradine. Evobradine really act on the final channels which are found in the SE node and AV node, and so it acts on not on the beta receptors in the cardiac muscle, it acts on the automaticity in the AV node and SE node, and so it is an effective drug in decreasing the heart rate in patient who taking beta blocker and ACE inhibitors and is still really accepting low ejection fraction less than 35 and heart rate more than 70 beats per minute. Mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists is very important, and we have the non-specific one, spironolactone, and we have the specific now, ibzerinone and finerenone, and they act on specific receptors in contrast to spironolactone, which act on glucocorticoid and progesterone receptors and androgen receptors, and so may cause gynecomastia and impotence and some problems in steroid disorders and so on. And we can use now the specific mineralocorticoid antagonist, which is ibzerinone and finerenone. Hydralazine, abrazoline, or isosorbide dinitrate also is very good drug for decreasing the afterload and the preload. Hydralazine reduces systemic vascular resistance and the dilating arterioles, and really it improves the renal perfusion. Isosorbide dinitrate also is a vasodilator and very important in treating left ventricular filling, higher ventricular filling pressure. But sometimes may not be tolerated by some patient due to flushing, headache. As you know, it is a potent vasodilator. Gastrointestinal upset less frequently can cause positive ANA titers and the Lubas-like syndrome. Is hydralazine. Sometimes give you a picture of hydralazine-like picture and increase the ANA. Cardiac glycosides, actually, these drugs are very important, and all drugs, it has no role in improving the mortality or the hospital frequency of hospital admission and so on. It is a neutral and improving the symptomatology of the patient. And try if you give cardiac glycosides to attach to the low dose, 0.5 to 0.9 nanogram per mil. And so you have to check the therapeutic level of glycosides every 3 to 4 weeks to obtain the optimum level of it, to avoid the cardiac glycoside toxicity, which is the most important factor in admission to the hospital in some patients with glycosides. And try to use digitoxins because it is not depending merely on renal, like digoxin. Digoxin need renal function, good renal function. And so digitoxins is more safer. And the digitoxin therapeutic level is 8 to 18 nanogram per ml of digitoxin. Digoxin level, optimal level, 0.5 to 0.9 nanogram per mil. Of course, we can increase, and in some papers, they increase the therapeutic level, the allowed therapeutic level to maybe 1.5 and even 2. But the mortality rate and the toxicity rate is higher with level higher than this. And so try to attach to this level, therapeutic level, 0.5 to 0.9 nanogram per mil of digoxin, and 8 to 18 nanogram per mil for digoxin. The other drug with the interest ones, I think most of you oriented with that, which is a combination of ASC blocker and sacubitril, which is a nibrilazine inhibitor. And as I told, nibrilazine is endopeptidase, which destroy the natriuretic peptides. And so sacubitril prevent this inhibition and so allow accumulation of natriuretic peptide, which is it has a very good action, the vasodilatory action, and the natriuresis, and so on. And so nibrilazine is an endopeptidase that degrade natriuretic peptide and several other vasoactive substances like bradykinin, endothelin 1, and adrenomyogen. And so nibrilazine inhibitor, sacubitril, is very important in potentiating the accumulation of natriuretic peptide, LCZ696 and Tresto. Natriuretic peptide, again, what's the action of natriuretic peptide? It is secreted from the endothelium, and also from the muscle, from the cardiac muscle, B-type natriuretic peptide and atrial natriuretic peptide and the brain natriuretic peptide. And all of this has a vasodilating effect and increase the sodium and the fluid excretion, and also inhibits the hypertrophy and the modeling of the cardiac muscle, and stimulate vasodilations of the vessels, and suppress the sympathetic outflow activity from the brain. But it has a drawback, interestingly, because nibrilazine, as you know, degrades amyloid B, and in cases of using Entresto, amyloid B will accumulate and may give pictures of Alzheimer in some patients, and even in some other patients may affect the cognitive function. And so you have to follow up your patient during the treatment with Entresto. And so it has, Entresto has valsartan, AC inhibitors, AC blocker, and also sacubitril nibrilazine inhibition, and so potentiate the natriuresis, diuresis, decrease pulmonary congestion and systemic congestion. Also, it has suppresses the aldosterone secretion and has a vasodilatation and inhibition of cardiac fibrosis. Nesirtide also, it is a very important drug because it is a recombinant human BNB, brain natriuretic peptide, and act as natriuretic peptides also. It has causes diuresis of sodium and water and decrease aldosterone and causes vasodilatation and hypertension. But take care of these drugs may cause severe hypotension and renal impairment or renal function deterioration. So you have to follow your, when you give any vasodilator, you have to follow the renal function in your patient. Direct renal inhibition as a screen, but really it's still under research because it is effective only when we combine that with AC blocker like enalapril. And if we use it alone, it is not so effective. It is a direct renin inhibition, and so prevent renin from start from the renal tissue. Phosphodiesterase inhibitors, I spoke about it last week, as in amrinone, and vinorenone, milrenone. All these are inotropic and vasodilators, and they take care of hypertension, and given through IV infusion and ICU, and carry a good inotropic effect, and but really not affecting the mortality rate, not decreasing the mortality. It improves the lifestyle and improve the quality of life. Principles of heart failure management in general: maximize the dose of beta blocker and ACE inhibitors till you reach the optimum dose for your patient, deal with your patient and use diuretic dose, adjusted diuretic dose, monitor the adherence of your patients to therapy, education of the patient and the caregivers, improve access to care through telephone, through urgent visit, institute all evidence-based heart failure drug and advice management. Of course, your patients with exhibiting heart failure will have to use anticoagulant for him, whether oral anticoagulant or warfarin and aspirin. In patient exhibiting sinus arrhythm, no difference between warfarin and aspirin, both of them could be used. But in patient exhibiting atrial fibrillations or previous thromboembolic complications, we have to use warfarin or the recent oral anticoagulant. Drugs for heart failure proven morbidity and mortality till now, beta blockers, very important, ACE inhibitors, angiotensin receptor blockers, aldosterone antagonists, hydralazine, isodynitrate, very important. The other drugs which improve symptoms and do not prove mortality benefit, like digoxin, nesertide, low brain natriuretic peptide, intravenous vasodilators like entrostom and other drugs, inotropic agents like phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Diuretics and the fluid removal, very important, and you can use the intravenous loop diuretics, you can reach the maximum dose. We can use the drugs through intravenous bolus or infusion, the same, no problem. High dose, low dose, no difference. In patients refractory to furosemide, consider metolazone, thiazide diuretics, very important, spirol, lactone, and intravenous chlorothiazide. If the patient is refractory and edematous and with fluid retention, we can shift to ultrafiltration. In some research, some papers, they against ultrafiltration. And really, from my experience, really, it is very good for eliminating the water load and also, and very important, the cytokines which are present in heart failure. And so it is very important in improving heart failure patients, especially CRT, which is continued veno-venous hemodialysis filtration. We use the hemofiltration mode and really it get rid out of cytokines which are inhibitory to the cardiac muscles. Tolvaptan, sometimes they use colvaptan and tolvaptan as vasopressin antagonist to decrease the volume of water in the body and eliminate the water load. And I think it is beneficial in some patients. These are drug doses which are used for ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, and ARBs, and mineralocorticoids, and sacubitril. And we have to, as you see, you can use small dose and going up to the optimum upper dose according to patient response. Device for heart failure if the patient exhibiting refractory to medical and no improvement to medical to medication, you have to shift directly to device support and don't wait really, because if you wait, you will carry more deterioration to your patient. And if we use over medication, over inotropic, over adrenergic stimulation, you will injure your cardiac muscle more injury. You will create more injury to you to the cardiac muscle. Coronary artery bypass graft, if ejection fraction less than 35. You can put cardioverter defibrillator, very important in patient exhibiting arrhythmia or fibrillation. Cardiac resynchronization, very important in the improved mortality to make the two ventricles contract at the same time. Ventricular assisted device, also very important. Cardiac transplantation, ECMO, and so on. Cardiac resynchronization is very important, and you can carry it by a cardial approach through thoracotomy, but it is an open heart and open surgery, carries of course complication, or you can use transvenous approach, practical and established, and require access to the coronary sinus, and you have to inject the pacemaker leads in both ventricles to contract at the same time. Intra-aortic balloon or impella, I told about it. Intra-aortic balloon, as you know, it is deflated during systole to decrease afterload and inflated during diastole to increase the coronary perfusion and increase the perfusion. perfusion. Also, the impeller, it can take blood from the left ventricle and pushing it to the ascending aorta, and it can support the patient really and give you cardiac output of about 5,000 cc per minute and decrease the left ventricular end diastolic volume and end diastolic pressure, and so improve the oxygen and the coronary oxygen supply to the ventricular muscle. It is really becoming more popular now and carry a good action. You can use the left ventricular assist device in patient exhibiting severe failure. You can depend on continuous flow better really than pulsatile flow. You can lastly shift to ECMO or for transplantation if your patient is refractory. Pulmonary artery catheter rule in such patients really in severe cases like cardiogenic shock, renal failure, and short hemodynamic and by clinical assessment. You can predict the pulmonary wedge pressure and identify how much you can see the different volume and pressure indices inside the different chambers of the heart. You can predict any shunt in the cardiac muscle. And so if you will utilize pulmonary artery catheter perfectly and you are oriented with it, insert it. And if you are not oriented with its parameters and you can't interpret its parameters for the benefit of the patient, please avoid it to avoid any iatrogenic complications to your patient. Heart failure with normal ejection fraction, which is half NEF, which is the diastolic heart failure. Treatment maybe try to treat hypertension, diabetes, ischemic heart disease, obesity, sleep disorders, especially using CPAP. Very important. Use anti-ischemic, use anti-hypertensive, diuretics also, venodilators, maintain sinus rhythm, try to treat any arrhythmia, maybe use calcium channels as for lesiotic actions of the cardiac muscle. Non-pharmacological management in such patient, restrict sodium, of course, to 2 grams per day, risk factor avoid. I will try to make exercise at least 2-3 hours per week. Disease management is aspirin, beta blocker, nitrates, ACE inhibitors, statins, very important, exercise, smoking cessation, dietary counseling, and try to decrease lipids and so on. Restriction of sodium, exercise 2-3 hours per week, dietary assessment, very important. Blood pressure is normally keeping 149/90 mmHg. If the patient suffering from diabetes and renal dysfunction, try to keep it 130/80 mmHg. Also, lipid management decreased to 1 gram per liter or 100 milligram per deciliters or 70 milligram per deciliters if the patient is highly high risk. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory for pain relief, try to avoid it in heart failure patients because it precipitates more edema and retaining sodium and water retention, and they may initiate or decrease the potency of the AAC inhibitors. There are therapeutic approach also is promising, but not yet a proven potential like Riosuguate, which increase the cyclic, the guanylate cyclase at the vasodilators and decreases the pulmonary artery pressure or pulmonary hypertension. Also, omicative microbial, very good. It acts on the muscle itself, it acts on the myosin itself. And so it potentiates the contractility, the inotropic action. And if you increase the dose, you can increase the duration of the systolic function. But take care, if you increase the dose and increase the systolic activity, you can induce ventricular ischemia in such a patient. And you see here the drug can induce more contractility, more peak action, and more increase in duration. But this will lead to more oxygen consumption. The other drug, empagliflozin, and this used especially in diabetic patients, it causes more glucose diuresis, and it acts on the sodium glucose transport, and so prevent glucose absorption from the proximal tubules, and so enhance the glucose excretion, and so more diuresis, but it lead to genital infection due to accumulation of glucose in the genital tract, and this is a new drug and still under research. But it causes also with increase in sodium, and so this may be used in Siadish syndrome, which is empagliflozin. Because of time, I think I take more time. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Samir, for this comprehensive, up-to-date lecture. I don't have any questions from my side. Just many thank you for the lecture. Thank you very much.